no introduction, Jerry Pinto. He's the most recent, and it's a really work of fiction, M and the Big Hoom. Just recently won this award. It was published in 2012. For those of you who haven't read it yet, I envy you because you have such a treat in store. It's just a lovely book to read, and such a wonderful rendition. He says, when we were chatting, he was saying it's a very romantic version of what happened. And perhaps it is, but it's also an extremely moving version of what it takes to grow up in a family where people are living with mental illness. He's a journalist, has been for many years, and has also written many other books, Asylum and Other Poems, Confronting Love in 2005. He's been consulting editor at Man's World, and he has also written this fabulous, yes, this also I've read, which is a terrific semi-autobiographical book on Leela Naidu. For those of you who don't know her, she's one of the most beautiful women who ever lived, and it's a lovely book as well. So here is Jerry.
Can I keep time by that clock there?
Yeah. Ah, okay.
So, because I can go on like for hours.
So, yeah.
Okay, so three. At any point. Yeah? At any point. Press my cornament.
Would you prefer a cornament?
I prefer. I don't want to let there's a mic. Okay, so I'm not shouting anymore. Okay, thank you so much. We can play this a number of ways. I can do my Brahmin boy thing and I can impress you with my wide range of reading in psychiatry and medicine and sociology and all the other things that I generally do when I want to sort of, you know, you're playing that kind of role. And there's another role which we can also, or we can like shift between the two, which is, when people, generally the first question that people ask after they've read M and the Big Hoom is how much of it is autobiographical, which means, did you really go through all that shit, okay? Which like is the central kind of question. I understand that is that the question. I take it as a compliment because what they, I think, are saying is you should be a lot more strange than you are given those circumstances and situations. An American reader told me that I had been abused by my mother. Because, you know, when I was 8 years old or something, my mother introduced me to the notion of human procreation using several four-letter words. So it's, I mean, so according to her, that was abuse. I didn't think I'd been abused, but hey, you know, if I can play a victim card, I will with the best of everybody. Yeah? So fundamentally speaking, what 33 perspective is a perspective of intense helplessness in front of a medical system. When my mother was first, my mother had her nervous breakdown, as we used to call it in those days. Excuse me, is the sound all right? Because I'm getting feedback, yeah? Okay. When it was called a nervous breakdown in those days, and it covered everything in the known universe, you know, whether you were peeing your bed or you couldn't bear sex with your husband, or anything that happened to you which wasn't normal, was a nervous breakdown, and my mother had a nervous breakdown. My earliest memory of this is standing inside a large room where she was lying on a stretcher and covered with a cloth, and I was utterly sure she was dead because there was froth coming out of her mouth from the side, and that in my child imagination was death. My mother was dead. And this is a nightmare that haunted me for very often. Then, at a certain point in time, I had a growth spurt. I came to this size at about the age of 12 or 13, which has its advantages in a boys' school because you can then beat the shit out of people who are saying "Vedi ka bacha," etc., etc. You can take revenge. You can, you know, grind them in the floor as you wanted to. But it also means that for some reason, if you have the body of a man, you are assumed to have all the other abilities of a person. So I think I was about 13 when I took over my mother's medication, as in giving her the pills that had been prescribed. literally sometimes forcing her to take them against what she wanted, because if she didn't take them, she would then become unhandleable. Also, it meant when she needed to be taken to hospital, I would go with her. Now, there were two ways in which we went to hospital. The first way was when she was acutely depressed and she wanted to kill herself. And one of the things about the mental health system is, if you go to a hospital and you say the patient wants to kill themselves, they have to admit the patient. Because if they do not admit the patient, and then that you go back and you say, and your mother does kill herself, then the hospital becomes an abettor to the crime of suicide. Your mother is a criminal. Suicide in the Indian Penal Code is the only crime where if you attempt it and fail, you are likely to go to jail for it. And this is what causes, like many of the other laws, sedition, homosexuality under 377, allows for a systematic blackmailing of the victim's family. So I remember whenever my mother, and my mother was committed to going in a certain way. And we were equally committed thoughtlessly, I'd say now, completely realizing it was thoughtless. We never once asked what she wanted. When we found her with her wrist slashed, her neck slashed, wherever we found her, our only response was to immediately bandage her, clean her up, get her to hospital, and get her all right again. All right again meant that she would go up into mania, and then she would collapse into depression again, and she'd try and kill herself again. Not always, but very often. So it just meant we thoughtlessly yanked her back, and she hurtled back towards killing herself again and again as a cycle. And each time, a policeman would turn up in the house and would sit there and wait. And he would wait until the right figure was mentioned. When the right figure was mentioned, he would take it and leave, and the case paper would vanish. But until that point in time, because if you take someone who's attempted suicide to hospital, they've got to report it to the police. The police then have to take cognizance of it or tear it up, and taking cognizance or tearing it up depends on how much bribe you can get. So that's one perspective that I have. Is a perspective of sitting there with my mother when I was 14, and she's being entered into 33, for about the third or fourth time. She's a pro. She's an absolute pro at all this. She knows her way around the ward. She knows everybody. She likes ward 33. And this is the second way we take her, which is when she's in mania state. Mania state means you have to go to the hospital, and you have to say, she is likely to damage us. She's likely to injure us, so you have to admit her into hospital. She was never likely to injure us, but we told this lie. Because very often my mother, in this one-bedroom flat, which was claustrophobic, with four people living in it, five people if you count the fact that my mother was two people, literally, my mother often wanted a break from all of us. And when she said, like, just put me in hospital, I can't bear this anymore, we'd cart her off to JJ Hospital. I would tell the lie that she's trying to hurt us, and they would admit her into hospital. Matron Galgalikar, who had admitted her for 25 years or something, knew, and my mother knew that she was not going to hurt anybody, but they also knew that the lie had to be maintained in some way, and they'd take her into hospital. You know. So this was the second variety. So the second variety was my mother is fully conscious. She's there. She's talking. She's not crouched in a corner moaning and saying, kill me, kill me, kill me. She's able to talk. So, and this young psychiatric social worker is sitting there taking her case history. And I thought to myself, you know, my mother reads Mary Barnes. My mother reads T.S. Eliot. My mother reads Freud. Like, I mean, what are you going to ask her? She'll tell you. Just open a space for her to talk. Instead of which they went down this line, do you hate your mother? Do you hate your father? What is your relationship with your children? Do you masturbate? How often do you masturbate? And I thought, okay, you're asking her this, and my mother was perfectly happy with answering, masturbate, what do you mean by masturbate, young lady? Do you mean intellectual masturbation, or do you mean the kind of masturbation? So they were having a good time. It was not, but that was when I was thinking, Behind me was a Muslim lady in a burqa, okay, with her husband. And it was obvious that this Muslim lady was anorexic, because she was skin and bones. And he was telling anybody who would listen that she won't eat and she'll vomit and she'll just like, she's not eating, she's not drinking, she's not eating for 20 days. And everyone was giving salah. You know, everyone gives advice, everyone's a doctor. So they're telling him, no, she must be in love with someone. Kisi ne karni kar di hogi. You know, you go to this Baba, he will make her blow her nose and everything will be all right. I have to say this. In our despair over my mother, we went to those Babas as well. Okay, so it is not as if our treatment of my mother was like this glowing, elegant, postmodern, sort of like caring family. We were just about as fragile and hopeless and helpless as anybody today would be confronted by someone they love in a state of acute vulnerability. And that acute vulnerability could mean anything. I mean, you know, it could mean that one day she would want to take off her clothes and stand in the balcony. And this, in our society, is going to be parsed very differently than from any other society. So when you went to Ward 33, okay, so just for a moment, let me park that and let me introduce you to the rest of her family, which is two other sisters who also had mental problems and a brother who was an alcoholic. And the brother who was an alcoholic stopped drinking alcohol. He went into depression. So he told his cousin with whom he cohabits. He lives with his cousin. He said, I want to kill myself. So my tia Anna Perej rang me up and said, your uncle wants to kill himself. So I said, how serious is it? Do you think it'll be like I have to come now or tomorrow morning? He said, no, tomorrow morning will do. In my family, suicide attempts are ordinary, commonplace things. No one is particularly thrown by them, mainly because they happen fairly often. So the next morning I went with him to the hospital, Masina Hospital. This is 25 years later after my mother's dead. I haven't been to a mental hospital for yonks. It's all in the past. I get him admitted and they give me the same paper, same questions. What was your relationship with your father like? And I make him answer all of them. And at the end of it, there's a thing about whether you want ECT or not. So I like tick not, because I ask him, do you want ECT? He says, at that point in time when you're depressed, you don't have an opinion. You don't have a wanting or a not wanting. These are categories that belong in the real world. You don't feel like anything. You know, nothing seems to make any sense anymore, right? So he said no, so I ticked no, sent him off, right? The next day and you're not supposed to visit them for 10 days. This is the Masina Hospital rule. When you admit a patient, don't come for 10 days. I think, when I went away, I was thinking what a sensible rule that is for both sides. One, for the patient, you get like a little time off from your family if your family is the problem. And for the family, the patient is always a problem. So they get time off from the patient. So that 10 days rule actually acts as a kind of calming, actually like an in-between space where everyone can calm down and temperatures can be ratcheted down. And maybe you can rediscover the fact that you love the person as well. So I came back after 10 days and there were two burn marks on his forehead. So I looked at him across the room and I said, what have you done? You've given him shocks. So he said, yeah, but he said he wanted. I said, no, he didn't. So I went inside and I sat down with him and I said, why did you say you wanted shocks? Because they showed me the form where he'd signed. So he said, everyone was going, I also went. And you think, so, and I said, then after the first one, what do you feel? He said, nothing. I said, now what are you feeling? Nothing. But I'm not feeling what I used to feel, which was I don't feel like killing myself now. So I went away deeply conflicted. I told them stop, because already he's burnt. His forehead is burnt. It is time to stop this then. But the next bed next to him was a 14-year-old boy who was also getting shocks. And this 14-year-old boy was there for having hurt a friend of his in school in a violent fistfight. So this is the psychiatrist, and this is Masina Hospital with two attending psychiatrists. And my uncle chose, when he was released, he chose to go back to Masina, to one of those psychiatrists as his psychiatrist. Now, here's the deal. Ward rounds are conducted in a psychiatric hospital in exactly the same way as they are conducted in a surgical ward. So doctor, along with a couple of attendings and maybe MD students and a nurse, comes up to the bed and says, Joseph, how are you feeling? Joseph says, okay. Much better, continue the medication, next bed. Auntie, how are you feeling? Increase the Depsonil, reduce the large active. Next bed, and goes like that. It is a round of medication advice, and then it's you're out. Now, in this scenario, we're talking about patients' rights, we're talking about therapeutic communities, we're talking about like working with people. I'm talking about a middle class man in a good hospital in Bombay who is not brought into his treatment. And in fact, 3 days after he was admitted, I was cleaning out his room because depressed people tend to have like really dirty, I mean, they just get dirty. They don't bother about cleaning themselves. They don't bother about the surroundings. So I went and cleaned this room. And I found that he was taking Proxivon. Now, Proxivon is a drug that is given to you when you're in acute pain. It's like end-stage cancer drugs, that kind of problem. And I didn't know why he was taking Proxivon. So I went to the hospital and I said, why are you taking Proxivon? So he said, oh, I have arthritis pains. So that nurse, that physiotherapist was doing my physiotherapy with me, said, uncle, if you feel like a little pain, then you take Proxivon. And she gave me a prescription. I said, but do you feel pain? He said, no, before I went only I would take. So I wouldn't feel any pain. Now, he was overdosing on Proxivon. He had just lost the central feature of his life. If you're an alcoholic, if you're a dependent substance abuser, that substance becomes the central pole of your life. Everything revolves around it. You know, because for him, hiding the bottle, retrieving the bottle, getting the stuff, meeting friends, everything surrounded alcohol. There was nothing else. Everything else he did, which was working or earning money, was for the alcohol. Now you take that away, the raison d'être is gone. Now he's got to find another raison d'être. He hasn't had it. From the age of 15 to the age of 65, he hasn't had another reason to get up in the morning. This man has also been overdosing on Proxivon. Both these have been taken away from him. Obviously, he's going to go into depression. But no one in that hospital asked him, uncle, what medication are you? Have you been taking? Okay. So whenever I'm at round tables like this, I think they're valuable and I think they're important. I think they're like really, really important for us to see what can be happening and what should be happening. You should know also there is another world out there. And that world is the world where nothing works as it should. I went to Thane Mental Hospital once on a college trip together. And it's a walking catalog of horrors. You have only to go there once to see what is happening. It's slightly magical, because there is not one thing that seems to be right about it. So we went to, and this is the thing, de-addiction, mental hospital mein dalo. JJ Hospital has its recovering addicts also in the middle of everything. So as you walk into the ward and visiting, people will tell you, ma'am, pagal nahi hua, main sharabi. I am better than these people, I'm just an alcoholic. Or main drug addict. That's the attitude. But they all club together because the state has no way of dealing with this idea that people have made substance, a certain substance, a kind of pole in their lives. And they must therefore be treated differently from people who have mental suffering. There's no way, so they all stuffed into one thing, right? Makes it easy to handle. So we met Sunil, who's a drug addict, and Sunil tells me that stuff is easily available. Sunil is obviously blown. I mean, he's really flying. And he's just like, yeah. He's just like, and I asked him, I said, Sunil, are you high? He said, yeah. They grow the stuff here, man. It's like pure grade. So the staff grows marijuana in the back lot, gets the mental patients who are on therapy to deal with the drug, meaning to actually like weed the weed, literally, and keep it healthy, and then they supply it. As soon as he's beginning to tell us this, a psychiatric social worker steps in and says, Sunil, this kind of person. He says, man, sorry, I gotta go. And he goes. And Sunil is warned that he'll stay for another 3 weeks if he talks like this. Then he takes us into the shock room, electroconvulsive therapy. Each patient comes in with two other patients. Two patients hold one patient down. They zap them. They turn the head, because again, froth comes out. It's collected in a cup. It's thrown away. And that patient is rolled off the table, just completely rolled off. Falls like meat on the side of the thing. So you say, why are you doing that? They don't feel anything now, na? And then by the time they come round also, for the next 2 days, the doctor is explaining, the pleasure pain is not there. There's no emotion. There's no pleasure pain. So if they feel pain also, it doesn't matter. And then after having held someone down, that person has to get onto the table. And the next person comes in and holds him down. This continues till the last person goes in. Then they all are taken back to. Everyone's head is shaved. Prevent slice. If you have Down syndrome, the first thing that they do after they admit you is they take out your uterus. Why? Because you'll menstruate. It's dirty. We all know menstruation is dirty. And their menstruation means at least, full functional women are at least demonstrating that they are fertile, these people. Why should they have babies? The other advantage of this is that they are sexually abused. No one will ever believe them. And second, there won't be any evidence. They won't get pregnant. That's ground reality of mental health in India. Okay? That's ground reality. That's the perspective from Ward 33. Acute helplessness, acute sorrow, acute sense of failure, that I had to take my mother to a place like this. But there was no other place. So one of the things that my mother demanded routinely was put me in a home. I don't want to live here. I want to be in a home. Okay. So we went looking for homes from everywhere. And generally speaking, there weren't National Institute for Mental Health and Neurosciences, NIMHANS, which was the best of the lot, which we found, wouldn't have her because they need someone to be living close, and they needed this, and they needed that. Everybody had, I understand now what they were all doing. They were all producing these sorting mechanisms because there was such a demand. So in the last time, when I went to the Ranchi mental home, there was a woman who seemed perfectly all right. I was sitting and chatting with her. Very, very articulate and decent. So I went to the nurse and I said, she seems well. Why is she here? She said, why? What can we do with her? We'll send her home. They have moved. Families leave their relatives in mental homes and disappear into the night. Just abandon the house and go away so that they will never be able to go home. Ground reality. Calcutta Mental Home. A mental home in Calcutta was closing down at one point, and they had to actually send people back. Some people were happy. Some people were happy to take their patients back. Very small minority. Many of them had to be counseled and helped into, what if when you go and say to your family, take me home, they say, we don't want you. And they all said, most of them said, we don't want it. So what do we do with it? What are, if you should ever have someone you love in this sort of condition, there is a wound. Okay. In retrospect, I suppose she gave me the gift of empathy. She gave me the gift of compassion, understanding, In the times of India, I was called the nut magnet, because if there was anyone with a problem, they'd head to me and sit down and start telling me their stories. So I'm not But it is very difficult because you're helpless. And there is no, there doesn't seem to be any earthly way of you getting around it. See, for instance, like in the last 10 years, in M in the Big Hoom, M dies. Spoiler alert, if you haven't read the book. M dies. And then, you know, the family is a bit gobsmacked because they don't know how to live without her. That's not how it happened in real life, right? In real life, my father died, left my mother. My mother decided to live in a state of not knowingness. She was going to ignore that he was dead. She was going to believe he was alive. And this was an additional psychological effort. Because if you invent a fantasy, you must put a lot of psychological work into keeping the fantasy together. And if that comes out of a neuronal substrate that is kind of diminishing because of age, the work that you put in it is very rarely equal to the benefits that you're getting out of it. Which is why young people are the best fantasists. You know, they can invent and believe a huge range of things, including the possibilities of a perfect world. Which is why young people are generally the idealists. And this is possibly one of the blind spots that I saw in the program yesterday, this new belief in neuroscience as the possible answer to everything that is happening inside your brain. That it, you're just this chemical soup, and if your amygdala has not been working, or, you know, you've suffered brain trauma or a brain lesion in this part of the brain, then these are the results, right? Not that I have any argument with this. I'm a junkie for this kind of stuff. I read psychological, psychiatric, mental health literature with a kind of like avid passion, okay? I mean, like, I just can't get enough of it because, frankly, fundamentally, I'm worried. I come from a family where, on my mother's side, there were 3 nervous breakdowns. She and her 2 sisters had nervous breakdowns, all 3 of them. And the brother was an alcoholic. And when he finished with alcoholism, he had his nervous breakdown. So my genetic loading is huge. So I want to know the enemy if the enemy is inside. If the enemy has an outpost in my head, I want to know all about that enemy. I want to be prepared for that enemy, right? So I read obsessively about this stuff. So I'm so glad there is someone like Oliver Sacks around, for instance, who writes beautifully, almost poetically, on, you know, the man who mistook his wife for a hat, or the artist who goes colorblind and can only see in black and white. Or, you know, a woman who can't walk on a normal road because she has to pay attention to her body and direct her body to walk. She's lost her sense of locitation, her sense of the body in space. I love reading this stuff. But what it does tend to produce also is a kind of manic self-awareness, where every single slip is a slip that has to be monitored and has to be explained, or has to be, if I'm writing and I write A-V-E when I meant H-A-V-E, I'm asking myself, is this the beginning of a certain way of, like, is this a slippage, is this a fault line, is this a break point, right? So one constructs, of course, one various ways, devious ways of trying to console the self that, you know, the work is done, I've had good years already. You know, if it hasn't happened to you by the time you're 40, the chances are less likely that it will happen to you as you go along. This is kind of, what is the word for it? Psychiatric statistics. I mean, it isn't reliable, but it's something that keeps you warm at night. It's that sort of thing. I'm going to stop at this point and say, do you have any questions? And really, 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 I have tried really hard to be as vulnerable as possible and as open as possible, so I have absolutely no problem with a question from anywhere in your brain, even from the worst and dirtiest part of it. Yeah, so don't worry about that. Just ask the question. Any questions? Yeah, please.
And his only child as well. So he has no support, and his mother is only child as well. And her parents were no more. when anybody tells you about this, they're not asking for the whole book. They're not. They're just sharing. There is nothing wrong at that point in crying for them. There's nothing wrong if it is not being misunderstood and you're just giving them a very big hug. As a woman with a man, sometimes you know, that might go wrong. I'm not discounting that. But really your role is sakshida. You are there to listen. So when someone said listening skills were very important, I wanted to clap. Because our tendency, male tendency especially, is to give a solution. Women are a little better at that. Just listen and not. So, how should I put it? If you have been adequately parented, and who feels adequately? We all got a bunch of jokers and weirdos. Like, I mean, imagine if you have to think, you know, you just missed me up and you did this rubbish and you want to live your life through me. I know all about it. But you know, basically, your mom is not barking back and you've been adequately there. You've been adequately there. And you're talking to a friend who has not. They hate you for it. They love you because they're a friend. But they hate your adequate parent. Okay. They just long for a mother who can like make sandwiches and stitch one. You know, like, I mean, I was in a school which, if you your mother could not make your costume for the play, you were not in the play. So my mother, I mean, I would go home and say, you know, I can be the Marquis of Queensbury in this play that's coming up. And my mother would say, you know, tell them to do it modern style. Everybody wears modern clothes. Which I would tell your teacher, she can't stitch it, right? You're not playing it. Simple as that. So I just wanted a mother who would stitch and make a nice lunch box, you know, and you know, and come to school on Parents' Day and be presentable, not that thing. Who is expected to just present? So we hate you because you have that, and you don't, right? But often your normalness and your normal atmosphere in your home is soothing in a mad kind of way, and also makes us deeply, deeply grieved that we must come to your house to soon, to be soon. And third, it is in good listening. Don't tell me about, don't give me cuttings from the papers about what is happening in psychiatry in Venezuela. Just let me go. I'm not interested. Just listen. And don't share it at all with anybody, including with me. Don't ever tell me my story. Don't ever tell me this is because your mom is like that, so sometimes you're like that.
And I understand that. It's not part of the deal. I told you that from a place of very great nakedness. Because it's not just about me, it's about someone I love. And I told you, I ratted on my mother to you. So you don't have to give a coping mechanism. You're his coping mechanism. If you're a friend, you're his coping mechanism. And we'll be sometimes a bit of a trouble. Horrible, like, I mean, we're good friends, and we try hard and whatnot, da, 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 intelligent, blah, blah, blah. And also, like, we completely, we're watching you all the time to see whether you're going to condescend. You're going to judge me because of what I told you. Sorry, but that's like the lead, that's what comes. Yeah?
So I have a question in relation to, like, if you're living with someone who's actually, or like, if you're actually living day in and day out with someone who's actually experiencing any illness, like something like manic depression, and you made it a point as soon as a person gets diagnosed that you have to know everything about it. Like one of the things is curiosity. You have to figure out what the scientific part of it is and other things to deal with. So once you figure that out, there's this obsession. You start tracking everything. If the person's slipping into depression or going into mania, and you take in every sign, even normalcy as either a manic episode or, oh, he said something negative, is he getting depressed and stuff like that. So it's almost like your entire life kind of becomes that disease rather than the person. And there's no distinction. I find this also very difficult. How do you tell? Like, even people who do suffer from that, they can't tell whether they are the illness and what part of it is not the illness. And even you find that confusing.
I'll tell you what the solution to that is. You try to love the parts that you like, even the parts that are the illness. Yeah? And you try to say that the parts that you don't like are the illness. And it isn't necessarily always that way. So one of the worst things I have done in my life is to a friend. My mother had just died about 2 years ago, and then he got married. and his wife had a postpartum psychotic episode. And suddenly it seemed as if my mother was back in the room. And I couldn't take it. I really couldn't take it. And I knew also that my friend saw me as the guru of Pagalpan. Jerry is my go-to resource to understand what's going on with my wife. But I walked away from him. I just completely abandoned him. I couldn't take it again. Okay, I just wasn't going down that road and for anybody. 2 years later, I went and apologized. His wife had sort of recovered by then. He was very magnanimous. He said, you gave me a growth experience. If you had been there, you would have probably buffered me. But I had to look after my baby. Because his baby was born postpartum, right? I had to look after my wife, had to do my job. And I grew up. And we're still friends. But that's his badappan, not mine. And this that I did for him, I did by mistake. Okay? So I'm saying, now when he looks at her, he has to keep asking himself this question. I see this question happening regularly. Like when I go over sometimes unannounced, and I'll tell her, I walk in and I say, listen, you must not worry about what I'm going to eat. I didn't come to eat. I came to sit with you guys, and if I go home hungry, I'll be able to eat. But of course, Indian women cannot but worry about what are you going to eat, and I would have made, and I would have bought, and this is the time for that lovely kind of dal that comes out in the monsoon, and now you didn't let me cook that for you, and why is everything becoming this nightmare thing? Is this her disease, or is this just her being a woman? It's impossible. Okay, so when you inflict, see, we, in the moment, okay, in the moment that if you are living with the person and you have, I'm going to make another distinction, sorry. There are some that are given. My mother was given, right? Given my experience with my friend, I might not have stayed with a wife who went like that. I might have walked away. Yeah? I might not have been the big home kind of person who stays with his wife. I don't know. It's not a question that I've ever, but if it's a given person, someone whom you've been handed, yeah, it's different. But if it's a chosen person, then it's different. What do you do about the friend who rings up and says, I'm going to slit my wrists if you don't come over, and it's 3 in the morning. And then you go over and he says, I was just joking, come now, sit and have a joint. I just needed some company. And you think, it's not funny actually. But actually, 10 years later, if he's not dead, you might even be able to tell a joke about it. If he's dead, you might be able to tell a joke about it at his Shok Sabha. Man, stranger things have happened. I'm saying, but between chosen and given is a great deal. But in both places, there is love. No? I know this is like, we've had this wonderful morning where we've talked about all these things, but we've not inflected for love. When you love people, you try to think the best of them. You try to say, oh, she called me, he said, I have more sex appeal in my little finger than you have in your entire body. Say. And you say, well, that's only the mental illness speaking. But is it? That little doubt will remain. And that's the only barrier to that doubt is love. So how do you know? You don't know. You can't know. How do they know? Great self-awareness is not even a gift that is given to 1% of humanity in its most normal and rational shape. Can't you see how self-deluded your friends are? Often. And you would be surprised to know that your friends think you are self-deluded very often. We all go around seeing other people's delusions very carefully. Oh, you think you were saying that only because you're correcting her, but actually you hate her because she insulted you 2 years ago. I know that about you, but about me, I'm very clear. I'm not that kind of person. I just put things down and walk away. We all have these weird ideas about ourselves. How many times can you, count during a week how many times someone says to you, I'm not that kind of a person. Nobody is babes in their own mind. But everyone says this, I'm not that kind of person. I'm not like that. They are like that. Everybody else is. So this self-awareness thing, it's difficult when you're normal. How can you be self-aware if someone's also beaming in a a steady radio sound of like someone talking to you inside your head. Who is that someone now? Okay, so now let's, here's another very lovely philosophical question if you want. That is being produced, we know, by the cerebellum. The brain is supposed to be you. Now if that is being produced in your brain, then it is you. So your mental illness is you also. Now what? How does that get us further? It doesn't. Second, this is the role of the Jnan Margi. Yes, sir? What are you saying? Knowledge is armor. It is weaponry. It is defense. I will know all about this. I will pursue it and this will help me understand. Why are we? Why? Because our educational system has told us that knowledge is armor. It is kavachakundan. You will go out armed with knowledge from every institute that you, from the time you were in the KG till APU, you've been told knowledge is armor. So we bring this into play. When we neglect intuition, we neglect emotion, we neglect the possibility of just sakshidari. I'm watching you and listening. I'm here. I asked a very old friend of mine who was 93, and I said, you know, now what happened? Like, what makes you happy? So he said, you sitting in this room makes me happy. And he said, if you are with an old person, and you can actually, and they can take it, touch makes me happy. Because no one touches the old. Like, shit, illumination. And illumination that came just because I asked one humble, simple question. What makes you happy, rather than what makes me happy?
Sir, I would like to know how you held yourself up mentally, given the situation at home. And is M and the Big Hoom a kind of an expression of what you had pent up or throughout inside? Also, in the book, there are parts which are really funny. So how it's really courageous to take a humorous approach to something as serious as this. How did you manage to do that?
First question, there are three different questions, so I'll answer them three. I'll try and be short also because I tend to like, every answer is a thesis or something. Okay, so let's start with the first one. First one was humor. Okay, joy and grief is woven fine, a clothing for the soul divine. Under every grief and pine runs a joy with silken twine. William Blake. You won't go very far into a... My cousin N died. Okay, and he died in...
...in horrible circumstances. I think N put off the... Let me see. He doesn't want to talk about it. But 20 minutes into his wake, we were laughing and joking and singing songs that he wanted to sing. And, you know, and generally having a great time because we were celebrating life as well. So, you would actually have to be very ill, very, very ill not to be able to laugh. Anhedonia is a terrible symptom of schizophrenia, inability to feel pleasure. Luckily, my mother was not a schizophrenic, so she often laughed at
herself. She often called herself mad and laughed at it. You know, so, just like, who was saying rigor mortis in the morning? You know, humor, remember, the Jews laughed in Auschwitz. They told jokes in Auschwitz. They got through it that way. We'll get through this current time by telling jokes. Our world right now is fairly blasted heat. But we'll laugh about it and we'll overcome because we laugh. Okay? But we also will cry. And we will weep. And we will say hurtful things to people. And that is the not holding up moment. See, so the tendency is to think of a person as a monolith, right? Jerry Pinto now has written this book and he's won this prize and he's wearing this nice shirt, by the way, which is secondhand. And he's here and he's talking about this and, you know, he's obviously at the top of his game. What a great thing. And he had this terrible start. But Jerry Pinto will go home now and will let himself down over something. He will not be the good friend he wants to be. He will insult someone he loves by mistake. He will let someone down. So even in your association with your parents, you will both be this glorious child that they love, and you will be this terrible tragedy that they had you at all. Yeah? And every parent feels like that, and you feel like that about your parents also. Well, you just could understand what I'm saying once in your life. Just try and be me, then you'll know. All these things that we say to our parents who are thinking, it's like, I'm paying all that money to put you in that stupid university, and I get this out of it. But you, I don't understand you. I won't sign the next check, then you'll see. But even as they say this, they know that they will sign the next check. So they've let themselves down in their own anger. They would love to be that tough love parent who would not sign the check so that you would learn. But they'll sign it because you're sitting in your room crying. We do this. So no one ever gets through or, you know, there's a passage in M in the Big Hoom where he calls her bitch angrily. You think like bitch is a mild word for what went on inside my head. Bitch is what came out. But inside my head, there were like terrible words for my mother. Terrible, terrible anger. But I had a very, in the third standard, there was a very sweet teacher who came. And I was incontinent right up to the fifth standard or something. It's like all that coming out, you know. And so I was pointed out to her as, this is our star pupil who is very bright but shits in his pants. Okay, so I remember thinking, how dare you introduce me like that? In an incoherent child way. Like, can't you just say, I might not shit today. And she's only here for a day. She might go away and never know this about me. She might only know the intelligent person I am. And you told her this. And at the end of the class, she took the class very nicely, but she came up, she was from some advanced education learning institute or something. She came up to me and she said, you know, when you're angry, you know, go to the toilet and say whatever you want aloud. Don't say it to the person because they may beat you. But say whatever you want aloud. And I learned to talk a lot loudly, but in private. And that has often worked as a kind of like, I lecture everybody in private. I tell everyone what I think about them. Then I come out feeling very calm and relieved. But it's one, okay, it's not, it's my personal strategy. I write poetry as well. I go for run. I run. I try to be as healthy as possible. I try to sleep as much as possible. I try to make meaningful relationships with humanity. All that, everything that I can to be mentally healthy, I am all over it like butter and jam. Okay? So when people say this question of what was inside me and whether it came out in the book, yes. But every book is like that. When I wrote Helen, it was because I fell in love with Helen dancing on the screen. And I thought, ooh, that's cute. And so I wrote the book on Helen. And when I met Leela Naidu the first time, Domna Rice was being really nasty to me. And Leela was being very nice. And she could see, I was a nice, you know, Mahim ka ladka, which means I was from a lower middle class background. And you knock on that door, and someone opens it in a white jacket. And you think, this must be the owner. And it's not, it's the butler. It's like, freaking butler? And then he produces a salver and says, can I have your card? I don't have a card. So he says, tell me your name then. So I said, OK, my name is Jerry Pinto. Could you wait here a moment? I've stumbled into PG Woodhouse. Where did this come from? And then I'm ushered into a room and, you know, we're all having tea. And, yeah. And this stupid Domrai says, syrup or liquor? And I'm thinking, means? Tea, I said. So Leela saying sweetly, he means, do you want the first cup or do you want the second cup? I had no idea the first cup is syrup and the second cup is liquor, which comes out of a teapot. Who invents this shit? What possible use is it in the world? Syrup and liquor. Yeah, but I said, okay, now give syrup, give liquor, anything. I'm still It was horrid. So I wrote the Leela Naidu book because I loved Leela, for being just gentle with me at that moment. Just being kind and pretending that it didn't matter. That Sirupalika, who knows about this? It was very sweet of her. He, of course, obviously thought I was completely. I won't even ask him if he wants cream. Dummy, she said, you should just ask if he wants milk. So I said, yeah, yeah, milk will do. But this time I just didn't want to interview the bastard. I just wanted to hit him. Oh, sorry, yeah.
I want to teach, and I struggle about talking about my clinical depression with the children I want to teach. I know that I want to talk to them about it, but I wonder whether they ought to know, if I should talk to them. I want to teach adolescents, basically, so around 10, 12 onwards. And I struggle with it often, think about it, whether I should or should not, and they should have a choice in that matter, and you know. Yeah.
See. By the time you're an adolescent, you have already gone through shit. You've already been depressed. You've already been elated. You've already been disappointed. All that is there. But, okay, and this is where understanding and self-awareness. If I know my class has a warm feeling for me, I'll be as open and vulnerable as I have been here. I'll tell them anything they want to know. Yeah? But children are also brutes and beasts and animals. Okay, don't romanticize, don't sentimentalize them. If you feel that they will take this and use it against you, don't. So you've got to smell, keep smelling that glass. You've got to keep looking at their tenor. And you've got to keep, see, because of our system is this kind of a top-down kind of system. It's a one-way system. It's very rarely, I mean, I started teaching when I was 16 or something. So I must have been a brute of a teacher at that point, because I was teaching kids mathematics. Okay, yeah, from 16 to 30, I taught mathematics. Yeah, yeah. Bahut papad bele humne. Kahin kahin tarah ke papad bele. Anyway, so I was teaching mathematics, and I know that I, you know, even when my students loved me, I used that to manipulate them. And there was genuine affection after a while. Because this person's thrown you a lifeline and is pulling you slowly out of the sea where you're drowning in math. Okay? He's rebuilding from. I was a good math teacher. But in order to get them, speed them up, I'd often manipulate them. So I'd say, oh, Imran, you only did 10 sums. I thought you'd have done 15. That's all right, it's all right. It's like, it's kind of like, you shouldn't do this to children. I think of it, he's still a buddy now, Imran's a friend, so I can use him as an example, because I feel, okay, I didn't mess him up too much. But, no, I'm actually, really, seriously, how much damage we can do as teachers. She's like, oh, it's incredibly, incredibly strange. Like, right till today, I was in Whistling Woods, right, recently. Whistling Woods is another big institution, but it is like FTII, except it is FTII for Bollywood. So everyone who's sitting in that class wants to be in Bollywood. So it's very easy to mock them because they have Bollywood dreams. So, and they asked me to come and do, and of course the teachers are all from APU type teachers. So teachers are in one plane of, you know, like, oh, we need to do some Chomsky with them to get them to understand. And these people are saying, oh. Like, and this, the gang sitting in the audience is saying, item number kabhi dalne ka, okay. So it's a complete mismatch because the teachers are all retired philosophy professors. I will, you know, I'm trying to reshape the ideological substratum. And then we will be, then let them go and make that those films, but at least let them be aware of post-feminism. They are not, they don't know Mary Shelley, but anyway. So I go into the class and I've been asked to talk about from text to image, the journey of a word to the screen. Talking about it, and suddenly one big hand goes up in the back. Nice muscular boy. So I say, yes, and muscular boy says, oh, can I ask a question? So I say, yeah, please go ahead. So everyone comes in and says, sir, like, read. What if you don't want to read? What if you don't like to read also? So now at this point in time, inflection moment, and I think this may have been where I started maturing also. So easy to mock a kid like that. No? Because obviously he's from somewhere in North India. Obviously he's kind of like, he's here because he wants to be a Bollywood star. He's only pretending he wants to be an AD. Because he's heard that Yashraj mein AD banne ka, or you have to walk around in tight t-shirts and then one of the guys will say, you're in my next film. Okay? It's that kind of like, they know this deal is already worked. So is that dream, it may not be my dream, but can I just respect it? So actually I said, give me a moment and let me think about this. And then it did come up with an answer about how you can possibly be have a vibrant education without reading. Which is the answer was, it was a very strange answer I thought of. Nissim Ezekiel and Arun Kolatkar bought season tickets for a film festival of Czechoslovakian films. They arrived in the theater and found that there were no subtitles. But they had paid for their tickets, so they were not going to leave. So they decided, okay, we'll sit here and you tell me the story of this film as I'm watching it. And in the next film, I will tell you the story. And they sat there and did that. And I thought, this is a great exercise actually. It's a non-verbal exercise. It's an exercise in understanding visuals. So I said, now take this and see if you can use it. See if you can see a film three times. Once with the soundtrack, once without. See if you can make rigor. What is reading but rigor? Why are you given so much to read? Because they expect you to be rigorous. If you don't want to read and you want to explore knowledge in some other way, find a way to be rigorous in that exploration. If you can open these spaces for your kids, you will have done your work. Whether they remember what you teach or not is not important anymore, not in this day and age, when everything is available on, you know, I'm sure today they would have downloaded the subtitles from some subtitle.com, gone to the back, pasted it on, and played the film by that time. It would have all been done in an hour. They would have done that, and that they didn't, that forced them to be rigorous. Can you make place for the student who is not like you and show that student how to be rigorous like you? Your job is done. Then don't worry about it. And everything else will be maaf because you have been gentle where gentle counted. And kids can take a lot of beating as long as it comes from a good place. If it comes from a bad place, then it hurts. You know this. You know, you've been savaged by people, but you feel okay, child. I could get over that. Question? Three-ten. I battered you into submission. Yeah, sure. Yeah, welcome.
I actually wanted to talk about this whole, in the West it appears that there are a lot of support groups for like family members of people who are going through something to talk to each other, to share their experience. In fact, part of the process of even healing is to meet a counselor as well as go to these support groups and talk about your experience. But there don't seem to be such networks over here, or I mean, if they are, they may be in their fledgling state. So maybe if you could shed some light on that.
I'll tell you, I tried to set up a network myself. Of people with, but it turned out to be like a, see, that might have just been me because I was very young and I wanted to change the world and I was like 18 and I thought, you know, I'd heard about such groups in America and like encounter groups and people sharing and whatnot. And I thought, why can't we do it here? We can't better than these people. I'm just an alcoholic. Oh, I'm a drug addict. Yes, mental thodi hun. That's the attitude. But they all club together because the state has no way of dealing with this idea that people have made substance, a certain substance, a kind of pole in their lives. And they must therefore be treated differently from people who have mental suffering. There's no way, so they all stuffed into one thing, right? Makes it easy to handle. So we met Sunil, who's a drug addict. And Sunil tells me that stuff is easily available. Sunil is obviously blown. I mean, he's really flying. And he's like, yeah. He's like, and I asked him, I said, Sunil, are you high? He said, yeah. They grow the stuff here, man. It's like pure grade. So the staff grows marijuana in the back lot, gets the mental patients who are on therapy to deal with the drug, meaning to actually like weed and weed the weed, literally, and keep it healthy, and then they supply it. As soon as he's beginning to tell us this, a psychiatric social worker steps in and says, Sunil, this kind of person. He says, man, sorry, I gotta go. And he goes. And Sunil is warned that he'll stay for another 3 weeks if he talks like this. Then he takes us into the shock room, electroconvulsive therapy. Each patient comes in with two other patients. They hold, two patients hold one patient down. They zap them. They turn the head, because again, froth comes out, it's collected in a cup, it's thrown away. And that patient is rolled off the table, just completely rolled off like that. Falls like meat on the side of the thing. So you say, why are you doing that? They don't feel anything now, no? And then by the time they come round also, for the next 2 days, the doctor is explaining, the pleasure pain is not there. There's no emotion. There's no pleasure pain, so they feel pain also doesn't matter. Then after having held someone down, that person has to get onto the table and the next person comes in and holds him down. This continues till the last person goes in, then they all are taken back to. Everyone's head is shaved, prevents lice. If you have Down syndrome, the first thing that they do after they admit you is they take out your uterus. Why? Because you'll menstruate. It's dirty. We all know menstruation is dirty. And their menstruation means at least, you know, full functional women are at least demonstrating that they are fertile, these people. Why should they have babies? The other advantage of this is that they are sexually abused. No one will ever believe them. And second, there won't be any evidence. They won't get pregnant. That's ground reality of mental health in India. Okay. That's ground reality. That's the perspective from Ward 33. Acute helplessness, acute sorrow, acute sense of failure, that I had to take my mother to a place like this. But there was no other place. So one of the things that my mother demanded routinely was put me in a home. I don't want to live here. I want to be in a home. Okay. So we went looking for homes. Everywhere. And generally speaking, there weren't. National Institute for Mental Health and Neurosciences, NIMHANS, which was the best of the lot, which we found, wouldn't have her because they need someone to be living close and they needed this and they needed that. Everybody had, I understand now what they were all doing. They were all producing these sorting mechanisms because there was such a demand. So in the last time, when I went to the Ranchi mental home, there was a woman who seemed perfectly all right. I was sitting and chatting with her. Very, very articulate and decent. So I went to the nurse and I said, she seems well. Why is she here? She said, why? What can we do with her? We'll send her home. They have moved. Families leave their relatives in mental homes and disappear into the night. Just abandon the house and go away so that they will never be able to go home. Ground reality. Calcutta Mental Home. A mental home in Calcutta was closing down at one point and they had to actually send people back. Some people were happy. Some people were happy to take their patients back. Very small minority. Many of them had to be counseled and helped into what if when you go and say to your family, take me home, they say we don't want you. And they all said, most of them said, we don't want it. So what do we do with it? What are, if you should ever have someone you love in this sort of condition, there is a wound. Okay. In retrospect, I suppose she gave me the gift of empathy. She gave me the gift of compassion, understanding, In the times of India, I was called the nut magnet because if there was anyone with a problem, they'd head to me and sit down and start telling me their stories. But it is very difficult because you're helpless. And there is no there doesn't seem to be any earthly way of you getting around it. See, for instance, like in the last 10 years, in M in the Big Hoom, M dies. Spoiler alert, if you haven't read the book, M dies. And then, you know, the family's a bit gobsmacked because they don't know how to live without her. That's not how it happened in real life, right? In real life, my father died, left my mother. My mother decided to live in a state of not knowingness. She was going to ignore that he was dead. She was going to believe he was alive. And this was an additional psychological effort. Because if you invent a fantasy, you must put a lot of psychological work into keeping the fantasy together. And if that comes out of a neuronal substrate that is kind of diminishing because of age, the work that you put in it is very rarely equal to the benefits that you're getting out of it. Which is why young people are the best fantasists. You know, they can invent and believe a huge range of things, including the possibilities of a perfect world. Which is why young people are generally the idealists. And this is possibly one of the blind spots that I saw in the program yesterday, this new belief in neuroscience as the possible answer to everything that is happening inside your brain. That it, you're just this chemical soup, and if your amygdala has not been working, or, you know, you've suffered brain trauma or a brain lesion in this part of the brain, then these are the results, right? Not that I have any argument with this. I'm a junkie for this kind of stuff. I read psychological, psychiatric, mental health literature with a kind of like avid passion, okay? I'm like, I just can't get enough of it because frankly, fundamentally, I'm worried. I come from a family where on my mother's side, there were three nervous breakdowns. She and her two sisters had nervous breakdowns, all three of them. And the brother was an alcoholic, and when he finished with alcoholism, he had his nervous breakdown. So my genetic loading is huge. So I want to know the enemy if the enemy is inside. If the enemy has an outpost in my head, I want to know all about that enemy. I want to be prepared for that enemy, right? So I read obsessively about this stuff. So I'm so glad there is someone like Oliver Sacks around, for instance, who writes beautifully, almost poetically, on, you know, the man who mistook his wife for a hat, or the artist who goes colorblind and can only see in black and white, or, you know, a woman who can't walk on a normal road because she has to pay attention to her body and direct her body to walk. She's lost her sense of locitation, her sense of the body in space. I love reading this stuff. But what it does tend to produce also is a kind of manic self-awareness where every single slip is a slip that has to be monitored and has to be explained or has to be, if I'm writing and I write A-V-E when I meant H-A-V-E, I'm asking myself, is this the beginning of a certain way of like, is this a slippage, is this a fault line, is this a break point, right? So one constructs, of course, one various ways, devious ways of trying to console the self that, you know, the work is done. I've had good years already. You know, if it hasn't happened to you by the time you're 40, the chances are less likely that it will happen to you as you go along. This is kind of, what is the word for it? Psychiatric statistics. I mean, it isn't reliable, but it's something that keeps you warm at night. It's that sort of thing. I'm going to stop at this point and say, do you have any questions? And really, 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 I have tried really hard to be as vulnerable as possible and as open as possible. So I have absolutely no problem with a question from anywhere in your brain, even from the worst and dirtiest part of it. Yeah, so don't worry about that. Just ask the question. Any questions? Yeah, please.
The thing is that honestly, everything you described is very similar to the story of really close friend of mine. And I've always struggled to find a way to tell him how to cope with any of this. But he must host it alone. And he's an only child as well. So he has no support. And his mother is an only child as well. And her parents were no more.
about this, they're not asking for the opinion. They're not. They're just sharing. There is nothing wrong at that point in crying for them. There's nothing wrong if it is not being misunderstood and you're just giving them a very big hug. As a woman, with a man, sometimes you know, that might go wrong. I'm not discounting that. But really, your role is sakshida. You are there to listen. So when someone said listening skills were very important, I wanted to clap. Because our tendency, male tendency especially, is to give a solution. Women are a little better at that. Just listen and not. So, how should I put it? If you have been adequately parented, and who feels adequately? We all got a bunch of jokers and weirdos. You know, you just missed me up and you did this rubbish and you want to live your life through me. I know all about it. But you know, basically, your mom is not barking that, then you've been advocating there. You've been advocating there. And you're not a friend who has stopped. They hate you for it. They love you because they're a friend. But they hate your adequate parent. Okay. They just long for a mother who can like make sandwiches and stitch one. You know, like, I mean, I was in a school which, if you, your mother could not make your costume for the play, you were not in the play. So my mother, I mean, I would go home and say, you know, I can be the Marquis of Queensbury in this play that's coming up. And my mother would say, you know, tell them to do it modern style. Everybody wears modern clothes. She can't stitch it, right? You're not playing it. Simple as that. So I just wanted a mother who could stitch and make a nice lunch box, you know, and you know, and come to school on Parents' Day and be presentable, not that thing. Who is expected to just present? So we hate you because you have that, and you don't, right? But often your normalness and your normal atmosphere in your home is soothing in a man kind of way, and also makes us deeply, deeply grieve that we must come to your house to soon, to be soon. And third, it is in good listening. Don't tell me about, like, don't give me cuttings from the papers about what is happening in psychiatry in Venezuela. Just let me go. Not interested. Just listen. And don't share it at all with anybody, including with me. Don't ever tell me my story. Don't ever tell me this is because your mom is like that, so sometimes you're like that. And I understand that. It's not part of the deal. I told you that from a place of very great nakedness. Because it's not just about me, it's about someone I love. And I told you, I ratted on my mother to you. So you don't have to give a coping mechanism. You're his coping mechanism. If you're a friend, you're his coping mechanism. And we'll be sometimes a bit of a trouble. Horrible, like, I mean, we're good friends, and we try hard and whatnot, we're intelligent, blah, blah, blah. And also, like, we're watching you all the time to see whether you're going to condescend. You're going to judge me because of what I told you. Sorry, but that's like the deal, that's what comes. Yeah?
So, I have a question in relation to, like, if you're living with someone who's actually, or like, if you're actually living day in and day out with someone who's actually experiencing any illness, like something like manic depression, and you made it a point as soon as a person gets diagnosed that you have to know everything about it. Like one of the things is curiosity. You have to figure out what the scientific part of it is and other things to deal with. So once you figure that out, there's this obsession. You start tracking everything. If the person's slipping into depression or going into mania, and you take in every sign, even normalcy as either a manic episode or, oh, he said something negative, is he getting depressed and stuff like that. So it's almost like your entire life kind of becomes that disease rather than the person. And there's no distinction. I find this also very difficult. How do you tell? Like, even people who do suffer from that, they can't tell whether they are the illness and what part of it is not the illness. And even you find that confusing.
I'll tell you what the solution to that is. You try to love the parts that you like, even the parts that are the illness. Yeah? And you try to say that the parts that you don't like are the illness. And it isn't necessarily always that way. So one of the worst things I have done in my life is to a friend. My mother had just died about 2 years ago, and then he got married. And His wife had a postpartum psychotic episode. And suddenly it seemed as if my mother was back in the room. And I couldn't take it. I really couldn't take it. And I knew also that my friend saw me as the guru of Pagalpan. Jerry is my go-to resource to understand what's going on with my wife. But I walked away from him. I just completely abandoned him. I couldn't take it again. Okay, I just wasn't going down that road and for anybody. 2 years later, I went and apologized. His wife had sort of recovered by then. He was very magnanimous. He said, you gave me a growth experience. If you had been there, you would have probably buffered me. But I had to look after my baby. Because his baby was born, postpartum, right? I had to look after my wife, had to do my job. And I grew up. And we're still friends. But that's his badappan, not mine. And this that I did for him, I did by mistake. Okay? So I'm saying, now when he looks at her, okay, he has to keep asking himself this question. I question happening regularly. Like, when I go over sometimes, unannounced, and I'll tell her, you know, I walk in and I say, listen, you must not worry about what I'm going to eat. I didn't come to eat. I came to sit with you guys, and if I go home hungry, I'll be able to eat. But of course, Indian women cannot but worry about what are you going to eat, and I would have made, and I would have bought, and this is the time for that lovely kind of dal that comes out in the monsoon, and now you didn't let me cook that for you, and you... Why is everything becoming this nightmare thing? Is this her disease, or is this just her being a woman? It's impossible. Okay, so when you inflict, see, we, in the moment, okay, in the moment that if you are living with the person and you have, I'm going to make another distinction, sorry. There are some that are given. My mother was given, right? Given my experience with my friend, I might not have stayed with a wife who went like that. I might have walked away. Yeah, I might not have been the Big Hoom kind of person who stays with his wife. I don't know. It's not a question that I will. But if you are, if it's a given person, someone whom you've been handed, yeah, it's different. But if it's a chosen person, then it's different. What do you do about the friend who rings up and says, I'm going to slit my wrists if you don't come over, and it's 3 in the morning. And then you go over and he says, I was just joking. Come now, sit and have a joint. I just needed some company. And you think, it's not funny, actually. But, actually, I mean, 10 years later, if he's not dead, you might even be able to tell a joke about it. If he's dead, you might be able to tell a joke about it at his Shok Sabha. Man, stranger things have happened. I'm saying, but between chosen and given is a great deal. But in both places, there is love. No? I know this is like it's, we've had this wonderful morning where we've talked about all these things, but we've not inflected for love. When you love people, you try to think the best of them. You try to say, oh, she called me, he said, I have more sex appeal in my little finger than you have in your entire body. Say. And you say, well, that's only the mental illness speaking. Okay. But is it? That little doubt will remain. And that's the only barrier to that doubt is love. So how do you know? You don't know. You can't know. How do they know? Great self-awareness is not even a gift that is given to 1% of humanity in its most normal and rational shape. Can't you see how self-deluded your friends are? Often. And you would be surprised to know that your friends think you are self-deluded very often. We all go around seeing other people's delusions very carefully. Oh, you think you were saying that only because you're correcting her, but actually you hate her because she insulted you 2 years ago. I know that about you, but about me, I know. I'm very clear. I'm not that kind of person. I just put things down and walk away. We all have these weird ideas about ourselves. How many times can you, you know, count during a week how many times someone says to you, I'm not that kind of a person. Nobody is babes in their own mind. You know? But everyone says this, I'm not that kind of person. You know, I'm not like that. They are like that. Everybody else is. So this self-awareness thing, it's difficult when you're normal. What if, how can you be self-aware if someone's also beaming in a a steady radio sound of like someone talking to you inside your head. Who is that someone now? Okay, so now let's, here's another very lovely philosophical question if you want. That is being produced, we know, by the cerebellum. The brain is supposed to be you. Now if that is being produced in your brain, then it is you. So your mental illness is you also. Now what? How does that get us further? It doesn't. Second, this is the role of the Jnan Margi. Yes, sir? What are you saying? Knowledge is armor. It is weaponry. It is defense. I will know all about this. I will pursue it and this will help me understand. Why? Because our educational system has told us that knowledge is armor. It is kavachakundal. You will go out armed with knowledge from every institute that you, from the time you were in the KG till APU, you've been told knowledge is armor. So we bring this into play. When we neglect intuition, we neglect emotion, we neglect the possibility of just sakshidari. I'm watching you and listening. I'm here. I asked a very old friend of mine who was 93, and I said, you know, now what happened? Like, what makes you happy? So he said, you sitting in this room makes me happy. And he said, if you are with an old person, and you can actually, and they can take it, touch makes me happy. Because no one touches the old. Like, shit, illumination. And illumination that came just because I asked one humble, simple question. What makes you happy, rather than what makes me happy? Yeah? Sorry, any other? Yeah, please.
So I would like to know how you held yourself up mentally, given the situation at home. And is M and the Big Hoom a kind of an expression of what you had pent up or throughout inside? Also, in the book, there are parts which are really funny. It's really courageous to take a humorous approach to something as serious as this. How did you manage to do that?
Okay, so first question, there are three different questions, so I'll answer them three. I'll try and be short also because I tend to like, every answer is a thesis or something. Okay, so let's start with the first one. First one was humor. Okay, joy and grief is woven fine, a clothing for the soul divine. Under every grief and pine, runs a joy with silken twine. William Blake. You won't go very far into a... My cousin N died. Okay, and he died in...
I think in horrible circumstances. I think N put off the... Let's see. He doesn't want to talk about it. But 20 minutes into his wake, we were laughing and joking and singing songs that he wanted to sing. And, you know, and generally having a great time because we were celebrating life as well. So... You would actually have to be very ill, very, very ill not to be able to laugh. Anhedonia is a terrible symptom of schizophrenia, inability to feel better. Luckily, my mother was not a schizophrenic, so she often laughed at
herself. She often called herself mad and laughed at it. You know, so just like, who was saying rigor mortis in the morning? Someone, you know, humor, remember, the Jews laughed in Auschwitz. They told jokes in Auschwitz. They got through it that way. We'll get through this current time by telling jokes. Our world right now is fairly blasted heat. But we'll laugh about it and we'll overcome because we laugh. Okay? But we also will cry. And we will weep. And we will say hurtful things to people. And that is the not holding up moment. See, so... The tendency is to think of a person as a monolith, right? Jerry Pinto now has written this book and he's won this prize and he's wearing this nice shirt, by the way, which is secondhand, and he's here and he's talking about this and, you know, he's obviously at the top of his game. What a great thing. And he had this terrible start. But Jerry Pinto will go home now and will let himself down over something. He will not be the good friend he wants to be. He will insult someone he loves by mistake. He will let someone down. So even in your association with your parents, you will both be this glorious child that they love, and you will be this terrible tragedy that they had you at all. Yeah? And every parent feels like that, and you feel like that about your parents also. Well, you just could understand what I'm saying once in your life. Just try and be me, then you'll know. All these things that we say to our parents who are thinking, it's like, I'm paying all that money to put you in that stupid university, and I get this out of it. But you, I don't understand you. I won't sign the next check, then you'll see. But even as they say this, they know that they will sign the next check. So they've let themselves down in their own anger. They would love to be that tough love parent who would not sign the check so that you would learn. But they sign it because you're sitting in your room crying. We do this. So no one ever gets through or, you know, there's a passage in Emin the Big Hoom where he calls her bitch angrily. You think like bitch is a mild word for what went on inside my head. Bitch is what came out. But inside my head, there were like terrible words for my mother. Terrible, terrible anger. But I had a very, in the third standard, there was a very sweet teacher who came. And I was incontinent right up to the fifth standard or something. It's like all that coming out, you know. And so I was pointed out to her as, this is our star pupil who is very bright but shits in his pants. Okay, so I remember thinking, how dare you introduce me like that? In an incoherent child way. Like, can't you just say, I might not shit today. And she's only here for a day. She might go away and never know this about me. She might only know the intelligent person I am. And you told her this. And at the end of the class, she took the class very nicely, but she came up, she was from some advanced education learning institute or something. She came up to me and she said, you know, when you're angry, you know, go to the toilet and say whatever you want aloud. Don't say it to the person because they may beat you. But say whatever you want aloud. And I learned to talk a lot loudly, but in private. And that has often worked as a kind of like, I lecture everybody in private. I tell everyone what I think about them. Then I come out feeling very calm and relieved. But it's one, okay, it's my personal strategy. I write poetry as well. I go for run. I run. I try to be as healthy as possible. I try to sleep as much as possible. I try to make meaningful relationships with humanity. All that, everything that I can to be mentally healthy, I am all over it like butter and jam. Okay? So when people say this question of what was inside me and whether it came out in the book, yes. But every book is like that. When I wrote Helen, it was because I fell in love with Helen dancing on the screen. And I thought, ooh, that's cute. And so I wrote the book on Helen. And when I met Leela Naidu the first time, Domna Rice was being really nasty to me. And Leela was being very nice. And she could see, I was a nice, you know, Mahim ka ladka, which means I was from a lower middle class background. And you knock on that door, and someone opens it in a white jacket. And you think, this must be the owner. And it's not, it's the butler. It's like, freaking butler? And then he produces a salver and says, can I have your card? I say, oh, I don't have a card. So he says, tell me your name then. So I said, okay, my name is Jerry Pinto. Could you wait here a moment? I've stumbled into P.G. Woodhouse. Where did this come from? And then I'm ushered into a room and, you know, we're all having tea. And, yeah. And this stupid Domra says, syrup or liquor? And I'm thinking, means? Tea, I said. So Leela saying sweetly, he means, do you want the first cup or do you want the second cup? I had no idea the first cup is syrup and the second cup is liquor, which comes out of a teapot. I mean, who invents this shit? What possible use is it in the world? Syrup and liquor. Yeah, but I said, okay, now give syrup, give liquor, anything. I mean, disgusting. It was horrid. So I wrote the Leela Naidu book because I loved Leela, for being just gentle with me at that moment. Just being kind and pretending that it didn't matter. That Sirupalika, who knows about this? It was very sweet of her. He, of course, obviously thought I was completely... I won't even ask him if he wants cream. Dummy, she said, you should just ask if he wants milk. So I said, yeah, milk will do. But this time I just didn't want to interview the bastard. I just wanted to hit him. Sorry.
I want to teach, and I struggle about talking about my clinical depression with the children I want to teach. I know that I want to talk to them about it, but I wonder whether they ought to know, if I should talk to them. I want to teach adolescents, basically, so around 10, 12 onwards. And I struggle with it often, think about it, whether I should or should not, and but they should have a choice in that matter, and you know. Yeah.
See, by the time you're an adolescent, you have already gone through shut. You've already been depressed, you've already been elated, you've already been disappointed, all that is there. But, okay, and this is where understanding and self-awareness. If I know my class has a warm feeling for me, I'll be as open and vulnerable as I have been here. I'll tell them anything they want to know. Yeah? But children are also brutes and beasts and animals. Okay, don't romanticize, don't sentimentalize them. If you feel that they will take this and use it against you, don't. So you've got to keep smelling that glass. You've got to keep looking at their tenor. And you've got to keep, see, because of our system is this kind of a top-down kind of system. It's a one-way system. It's very rarely, I started teaching when I was 16 or something. So I must have been a brute of a teacher at that point, because I was teaching kids mathematics. Okay, yeah, from 16 to 30, I taught mathematics. Yeah, yeah. बहुत पापड़ बेले हमने कहीं कहीं तरह के पापड़ बेले एनीवे सो आई वाज टीचिंग मैथमेटिक्स एंड आई नो दैट आई यू नो इवन व्हेन माय स्टूडेंट्स लव्ड मी आई यूज दैट टू मैनिपुलेट देम एंड देयर वाज जेन्युइन अफेक्शन आफ्टर अ व्हाइल बिकॉज़ दिस पर्सन हैज थ्रोन यू अ लाइफलाइन एंड इज पुलिंग यू स्लोली आउट ऑफ द सी वेयर यू आर ड्राउनिंग इन मैथ ओके ही इज रीबिल्डिंग फ्रॉम आई वाज अ गुड मैथ टीचर बट in order to get them, speed them up, I'd often manipulate them. So I'd say, oh, Imran, you only did 10 sums. I thought you'd have done 15. That's all right, it's all right. It's like, it's kind of like, you shouldn't do this to children. I think of it, he's still a buddy now. Imran's a friend, so I can use him as an example, because I feel, okay, I didn't mess him up too much. But, no, I'm actually really seriously how much damage we can do as teachers. She's like, oh, it's incredibly, incredibly strange. Like right till today, I was in Whistling Woods, right, recently. Whistling Woods is another big institution, but it is like FTII, except it is FTII for Bollywood. So everyone who's sitting in that class wants to be in Bollywood. So it's very easy to mock them because they have Bollywood dreams. So, and they asked me to come and do, and of course the teachers are all from APU type teachers. So teachers are in one plane of, you know, like, oh, we need to do some Chomsky with them to get them to understand. And these people are saying, yeah. And this, the gang sitting in the audience is saying, item number kabhi dalne ka, second row mein third row mein. Ye bata. Okay. So it's a complete mismatch because the teachers are all retired philosophy professors. I'm trying to reshape the ideological substratum. And then we will be, then let them go and make that those films, but at least let them be aware of post-feminism. They are not, they don't know Mary Shelley, but anyway. So I go into the class and I've been asked to talk about from text to image, the journey of a word to the screen. Talking about it and suddenly one big hand goes up in the back. Nice muscular boy. So I say, yes, and muscular boy says, oh, can I ask a question? So I say, yeah, please go ahead. Anyone comes in and says, sir, like, read. What if you don't want to read? What if you don't like to read also? So now at this point in time, inflection moment, and I think this may have been where I started maturing also. So easy to mock a kid like that. No? Because obviously he's from somewhere in North India. Obviously he's kind of like, he's here because he wants to be a Bollywood star. He's only pretending he wants to be an AD. Because he's heard that Yashraj mein na AD banne ka, or you have to walk around in tight t-shirts and then one of the guys will say, you're in my next film. Okay? It's that kind of like, they know this deal is already working. So is that dream, it may not be my dream, but can I just respect it? So actually I said, give me a moment and let me think about this. And then it did come up with an answer about how you can possibly be have a vibrant education without reading. Which is the answer was, it was a very strange answer I thought of. Nissim Ezekiel and Arun Kolatkar bought season tickets for a film festival of Czechoslovakian films. They arrived in the theater and found that there were no subtitles. But they had paid for their tickets, so they were not going to leave. So they decided, okay, we'll sit here and you tell me the story of this film as I'm watching it. And in the next film, I will tell you the story. And they sat there and did that. And I thought, this is a great exercise, actually. It's a non-verbal exercise. It's an exercise in understanding visuals. So I said, now take this and see if you can use it. See if you can see a film three times. Once with the soundtrack, once without. See if you can make rigor. What is reading but rigor? Why are you given so much to read? Because they expect you to be rigorous. If you don't want to read and you want to explore knowledge in some other way, find a way to be rigorous in that exploration. If you can open these spaces for your kids, you will have done your work. Whether they remember what you teach or not is not important anymore, not in this day and age, when everything is available on, you know. I'm sure today they would have downloaded the subtitles from some subtitle.com, gone to the back, pasted it on, and played the film by that time. It would have all been done in an hour. They would have done that. And that they didn't, that forced them to be rigorous. Can you make place for the student who is not like you and show that student how to be rigorous like you? Your job is done. Then don't worry about it. And everything else will be maaf because you have been gentle where gentle counted. And kids can take a lot of beating as long as it comes from a good place. If it comes from a bad place, then it hurts. You know this. You know, you've been savaged by people, but you feel okay, child. You know, I could get over that. Question? Three ten. I battered you into submission. Yeah, sure. Yeah, welcome.
I actually wanted to talk about this whole, in the West it appears that there are a lot of support groups for like family members of people who are going through something to talk to each other, to share their experience. In fact, part of the process of even healing is to meet a counselor as well as go to these support groups and talk about your experience. But there don't seem to be such networks over here, or I mean, if they are, they may be in their fledgling state. So maybe if you could shed some light on that.
I'll tell you, I tried to set up a network myself. Of people with, but it turned out to be like a, see, that might have just been me because I was very young and I wanted to change the world and I was like 18 and I thought, you know, I'd heard about such groups in America, like encounter groups and people sharing and whatnot, and I thought, why can't we do it here? We can't set here. And what, in the West, they're always startled at how much we rely on family. So if it could, actually I think we need to act, culturally be sensitive to this sharing thing and see whether the family can be made the unit of sharing. Not just the family, but like the extended family as well. Because often people don't know what to do, but they would like to do something. And sometimes it's as simple as come for 3 hours, sit with my mom so I can go and see a film. That's all I want. Let me go and see a film. Don't come and tell me, no, you should give her, you know, 3 glasses of water a day. When she gets up, first give her 6 glasses a day. 10 days later, it will all be flushed out of her. All these are toxins in her system. You want to say that it were that simple, idiot. By now, it would have been done and dusted. But anyway, so I'm saying, one, the sharing groups don't work because we're very We find vulnerability a great struggle. This is also because we have been taught by our experiences not to be vulnerable. We have been told, don't talk like that, don't tell like that. You know, like my friends come up to me and say, like, keep talking about that incontinency, it's gone. Like, it's long gone. Why do you have to keep talking about it? I said, because it happened. And, you know, it was there. And it dominated my life for a long time. It's all I have to think about. So, these fledgling, I mean, if the groups are fledgling, it is because it is entirely likely that they've not worked. And this is what I keep saying. When I ask that caste question in the morning, do we inflect for caste? In this country, Baluta, for instance, you look at this, there's a YouTube clip, this chilling YouTube clip. This woman in the 1950s or 60s ran a small experiment in her class on race, which is she announced that from tomorrow, and her class is on 5-year-olds or 6-year-olds, from tomorrow, all the children with brown eyes will be silent. All the children with blue eyes can speak. All the children with brown eyes will get less homework. All the children with blue eyes will get more homework. All the children with brown eyes, this one, what she was trying to do is try, within a week, depression has set in among those children who are not allowed to speak, being treated differently. Their reading scores have gone down. Their mathematical ability goes down. They just can't function because they just don't know why they're being treated like that. Now imagine you're a Dalit in a village school, being made to bring your own little piece of cloth to sit on. No one will give you water. And we don't think caste is important. In the formation of selfhood, in the arrival and departure of depression, we don't think it's important. What must it be like to be a Muslim today? I have no idea. I know a friend of mine lives in a huge building, you know, married to a Hindu, who feels she's living in a state of terror. She doesn't know when it's going to happen. The mashals, she calls them. And imagine if you're a poor Muslim living in a basti. What is that state about? Do we talk about these things? What if you're a Muslim kid in APU, and your parents are back home there, and you don't know what is happening in the basti? And every call may be something like that. What? These things don't matter in mental health. The fuck are we living in? Which country? Caste doesn't matter. Your God is not my God. I won't let you in my temple if you're menstruate. And this isn't put into the, like, our framework of thinking. I'm appalled, friend. And of course, everyone, all of my friends will tell me, why are you talking like that? You know it's dangerous in this day and age. Because you're a Roman Catholic. What are you saying? You're mounting an attack on Hinduism. Let me say this clearly. Caste is well alive and well in my community, as much and alive and well in Roman Catholicism as it is in any other community. The Examiner comes out every month. It's a magazine for Roman Catholics that is brought out by the church. It comes out with wanted Brahmin bride for Roman Catholic boy settled in Bahrain, earning 5-figure salary. It's not dead if you've converted 400 years ago. Oh no, sir. I'm sorry. So I'm saying, when we consider all that we consider about the brain, there's a recent book that came out called Democracy. What is Democracy? It's written by Sharad Paul. It's about how to decode Western shampoos and skin creams and whatnot for brown skins. It's selling like hotcakes. Every woman whom I have gifted it to has opened it and said, cocoa butter doesn't work for brown skins. I told you, cocoa butter doesn't work. Because I put it on my legs and my legs were dry. Bergamo doesn't work. What is Bergamo? I don't know Bergamo, but cocoa butter doesn't work. See, I mean, we can actually publish a book where we talk about how the Western world controls our skin products. But all our protocols are borrowed. All our drug protocols are borrowed. Sorry? We didn't run like clinical testing before we started a drug that was clinically tested on 6 foot white American boys, and we're going to give it to 5 foot 10 or less Indians, and not one Ajit Bhat. We are all the same, no, basically. Underneath, everything is the same. Yeah, of course. There are no elephants in the room. That's the elephant in the room. sorry. I get excited. I told you, I have anger management issues. My problem is anger management issues after all this time. I don't shit my pants. I just like scream. Yeah. Hi, Ganesh.
How was your experience being a journalist in terms of medical thoughts and why did you leave it?
When I started with journalism, I was 21 years old. I had a lovely time. It was journalism with really nice, you know, I'd walk into an editor's office and I'd say, you know, I want to write this piece on psychotherapy that is being conducted in a small village in Tamil Nadu. And they'd say, yeah, go. I'd say, Olive Ridley turtles are finally nesting again here. And they'd say, yeah, go. And slowly it came to the point at which they would say, yeah, but why is that of interest to our readers? I'd say, no, that's my job, right? As a journalist, I make it interesting to readers. But they'd say, no, our marketing department have told us that the readers are not interested in. I'd say, hold on. Readers in general don't know what they're interested in, what they're not interested in. Okay? That's why we go when we go to bookshops, we don't go with a list. You go with a yearning. You go in and you say, I will chal dekhne ka. You pick up a book and you smell it, then you read a page or two and you think, possibly, maybe. And then you go and pick up another one and possibly, maybe. And then third one, oh, definitely this one. You find out who you are because the buffet is large. If you shrink the buffet and say, this is what you are interested in, abhi le lo, people will fall away from the newspapers, which is what has happened. The newspapers ran, and this the Times of India single-handedly managed. Single-handedly the Times of India managed to turn itself into a marketing machine, and I was working for them. The problem is, the real problem is, in the world, it is the paper that makes the most money. More than the South China Morning Post, more than the New York Times, more than the LA Times, more than the London Times, the Times of India makes more money than all of them put together. And this was before they started TV. The last time I saw their recorded profit was 400 crores after tax. That's more than 1 crore a day profit. It's not a public company, which means they don't have to give share dividends to people. They take that money home, the family and the small number of people who own the share. And they control a huge amount of our thought processes, and they are dumbing us down every day by feeding us on this milk and malai of Bollywood and you know, cheap science and that kind of stuff. Then they have the gall to have a literary festival. They exile books and authors from the newspaper through the year, and then they have a literary festival. That was the kind of journalism I couldn't work in anymore. How was it working? When I was working, I had a blast. And my rule is I don't do anything unless I'm going to have a blast. And if I discover that I'm not having a blast, I'm out of there very quickly. I stop. So anything that I have done for years, I've done because I love it. Mail Jol is like that. The People's Free Reading Room and Library is like that. Jahangir Sabhawala Foundation is like that. All that I have done because I really wanted to do it. If I don't want to do it, I stop. And I think this is a very good way to run your life. It is not a very good money way. It's not like a promise of money. But I'll tell you one thing. Follow the love and the money will follow. It'll come somehow. There'll be enough. Not enough for you to ever buy a 3-bedroom house and the car of your dreams and go to vacations every year abroad. But enough money to live respectfully and decently. And then sometimes Wyndham Campbell Prize will
come. Every book has a particular audience. Sorry.
Hello. Every book has an audience in mind, okay? So what particular audience did you have in mind when you wrote this book? And what did your publisher say if you wanted to include more of people who'd read it in future?
See, one of the things that I was very clear about when I started writing was that I was not going to worry about the reader at all. It has never ever bothered me whether two people will read the book or 2,000 will read the book. I'm writing the book I'd like to write. I'd like to read. I don't care whether anyone reads it or doesn't read it, which doesn't mean that you shouldn't buy it when you go out. What I'm saying is this. You can't guess. See, it's a very simple thing. Like my mother, when I told her I'm writing about you, she asked me once, what are you doing? I said, I'm writing about you. She said, stupid. As though my life has any diamonds and blondes. And I said, what is that? She said, put some diamonds and blondes and then the book will sell. So I thought, and I did think about writing thrillers and writing big, fat books. You know, and it just comes a hota nahi hai. I write what I want to write, and then if it sells, it sells. If it doesn't sell, then phir bhi jeeta hun. It's okay. I don't know. I don't have any feeling that this should sell million copies because it's like that. I feel it will go out. Each book will go out, and it will do its work. It's like it has a little karma to fulfill that book. So it will go out and do its karma. That's all I want out of the book. Baki ka chhod. So when if it ever gets pirated, I would have the same attitude. Like, wo wahan bhi karma kar raha hai, yahan bhi karma kar raha hai. Choose. You want a badly printed, dirtily published book? Buy now, pirate it. You want a good, nicely published book? Buy this one.
So the royalties will
buy. See, right now my royalties on any book that I have written have been enough for dinner. One dinner in 1 year. Okay. So I do a variety of other things to keep going. Various other things. But the writing is what I subsidize with everybody. I have no problems with that. I have no, you know, sort of like feeling that I should sell more copies. I believe that, I remember this young woman picking up the book and said, she was holding M in the Big Hoom. I want to buy this, but I have so many other books at home to read. I'll just feel guilty. So I plucked it out of her hand and I said, don't buy it then. Because a book should be a pleasure. It should never induce guilt in you. Buy it when you don't feel guilty. So she said, you wrote it. So I said, yeah. Then you can sign it and I'll buy it. I said, but you know, even that is not a very, I mean, I don't mind you buying it and not reading it, but I wrote it for you to read it. So read it. I mean, wouldn't like it to be part of a pile of dusty books lying beside the bed, right? Each book saying, please read me my you bought me 6 months ago, not read me yet. I have books like that, I know. 212 at last count of which I have to read. But anyway, so I'm saying, to answer your question, the reader is an imaginary and mythical beast. I do not believe marketing people who say that. Okay, the best example, Cobalt Blue. Okay, so I translated Cobalt Blue, and I sent it off to Penguin, and Penguin came back and said, we'd love to do it, and we're going to give you 3 lakhs for it. I jumped out of the book. In my life, I had not received 3 lakhs. Of course, 1.5 lakh to me, 1.5 lakh to Sachin Kundalkar. Okay, because that's how translation is. Half goes to the original, half goes to the person who's writing. So I wrote to Sachin and Sachin said, is that enough, you think? I thought, he makes films now, na? So, uske liye 3 lakh kya hai? Wo ek din ka kaam pe karega. He has to direct an ad film, like it'll be one day and he'll get 3 lakh. So I said, Sachin, it is a very good amount. So then later when I met Shivapriya, who's in charge of the publishing, I said, how did you manage to make such a wonderful offer? I'm not arguing. I'm happy I took it and all, but how did you manage to make such a wonderful offer? She said, I stood up at the marketing meeting and I said, there is a book in which there is a gay romance and a heterosexual romance. And the marketing manager said, we'll sell that. Give him 3 lakhs. Okay. So, we got our 3 lakhs. The book has still not gone out of hardback. So it will take another 10 years before it makes its money. So it is stupid to give that kind of money just because you think, because eventually Cobalt Blue is a lovely romance. There's not one mention of the P word in the book. Or the C word. Or the other C word. It's just about this man who destabilizes this other man and says, don't bother about balance. Don't bother about symmetry. And people must be there saying, kidhar are they? And then they must be telling their friends, oh, what kari hai, aaj mein kuch nahi hai. So, this is that marketing manager's complete fool. So, I believe actually therefore, so, you know, see, I can look at all of you and I can be condescending. I can say, what do they want? They want to read about people like them. And they want to read about food and fashion and ethic. And so I'll put together a book like that and I'll feed it to them and they'll be, that's condescending. That's stupid. I don't think young people are like that. So I'll write the book I want and it resonates with them and they read it. Fine, if they want to read something, they'll read that, yeah? The world is large and there are lots of books and lots of fun to be had. You should go and read what makes you happy. And you have to read your textbooks also. They are like that teachers, what to do. Chalo, thank you so much.
No, I'm so sorry to be the person to bring that to an end. we could go on like this for the entire evening, I'm sure. But we do have one small point of business, which is that many of you would be aware that last semester Benson had held a course on mental health, and that the students in that course, they put together a directory, a mental health directory of services available in Bangalore city. And it's a remarkable little publication which we have put together and which we would like Jerry to release for us. That is it. Yes. Yes.
Is someone taking photographs of this moment?
There's
okay?
Plenty. In fact, I'm glad you brought that up.
We'll look at the book first.
Okay. We'll open it and then.
No, first, you have to look at the book. Then we'll open it. Oh, then we'll look at the book.
Jerry, thank you so much.
You wanted one, no?
Yes, I
have. Are you, that's Rhea.
Yeah.
She was saying she's interested. Yeah, so give her one. Like, photo.
So, anyway, what I'd like to say is that it's really a remarkable book. We will have copies of it at the Student Support Center. We will put it online. It'll be on our website. It's wonderful reference material. And we are hoping that every year Benson holds this course, we'll do it for a different location. So, you know, pretty soon we'll have directories across the wonderful country. So thank you very much, all of you.
Okay, commercial break. I'm outside signing copies.
Oh, yeah.